I'm sure you have calculated the volume of a cone with height h and radius r at least once in your life, with this formula. But where does it come from? You could convince yourself about it by doing a simple experiment. But here, we will get to it theoretically. In case you have searched a demonstration and got scared with revolution integrals, well, we will avoid that. First of all, let's see our approach. The real volume of the cone will be approximated by successive cylinders that we will adjust to the cone. The more cylinders, the better approximation. To calculate this volume approximation, we need to know the volume of each cylinder. Thus, we require their height, which is simply the cone's height divided by the number of cylinders, and their radius. How do we get there? Well, let's take a look at a section of the cone, and suppose we make an approximation with two cylinders. We end up with two right triangles, which bases are the radius of our cylinders. Here is where the first Thales theorem takes part. It claims that when we cut a right triangle parallel to any of its sides, we obtain a similar right triangle. That is, our new triangle is proportional to the initial one. And as long as we've halved the height of the original triangle, if the bigger base is r, then the smaller one is r half. This theorem can be extended for any number of cuts. We take the similar triangles and obtain their bases. So we will end with a sequence for the cylinder's radius with this pattern. Now, we know how to obtain the radius for every number of cylinders. Let's try to calculate some approximations. First, we consider only one cylinder, with radius r and height h. The volume of this first approximation is just the volume of the cylinder, p times h times r squared. For two cylinders, we have this sequence of radius by virtue of Thales' theorem, and h half for the height of both cylinders. The second approximation is compound by the volume of the two cylinders, p times the height of each cylinder times the radius of each cylinder squared. Now, we take the common factor p times h half times r squared. And finally, we arrange it so we have 2 cubed in the denominator and 1 plus 2 squared on the right side. With 3 cylinders, we extend the pattern for the radius sequence, and we have another height. The volume is compound now of 3 terms. We take out the common factor and arrange all again so we end with 3 cubed on the denominator and 1 plus 2 squared plus 3 squared inside the parentheses. If we rewrite V1, we cut into it a pattern in all these approximations. For example, we expect that V4 would have this form, dividing by 4 cubed and multiplying by 1 plus 2 squared plus 3 squared plus 4 squared. In this way, for n cylinders, we will end up with a general expression, dividing by n cubed and multiplying by 1 plus 2 squared plus 3 squared till n squared. Now, we have a formula for the nth approximation. And in order to obtain the volume of the cone, we have to consider more and more cylinders. But as n goes to infinity, we encounter a quotient, an infinite sum with more and bigger terms divided by infinity cubed. This is an indeterminate form, and to handle it, we should avoid that awkward infinite sum. So let's see what we can do. We will call s the sum till the nth squared. As n determines how far we go adding the squares of natural numbers, we expect that s is a function of n. Thus, for any value of n, we get a single value of s. For example, s of 1 is equal to 1, as we reach only the sum till 1. S of 2 equals 1 plus 2 squared, which is 5. And s of 5 takes the sum up to 5 squared, and we have 55. Now, if you want to have a first intuition of what is this unknown function, a good tactic is to plot it. When we see the plot of some values of the sun versus n, we could predict a cubic or quartic tendency. With a little effort with notation, we write S of n as a polynomial of degree m. We want to know if m is 3 or 4. Our goal is to manipulate this equality in order to have something we can plot to verify the value of n. For that, let's divide by n to the m minus 1, in order to reduce the grade of the right side. We end up with new exponents, and regrade like that. S of n divided by n to the m minus 1 is something we can plot. And according to the right hand side, if n is larger, all these terms will vanish. So finally, we end up with a linear function. Thus, for the correct m, as n gets bigger, S of n divided by n to the m minus 1 tends to a linear function. Let's plot it for m equals 3 and m equals 4. It is clear from this figure that m equals 3. Now, we can write S of n as a third grade polynomial. The last step is to determine these coefficients, and for that, we will need four equations. This can be easily obtained by computing some values of S for any n, and introducing that n in our polynomial. We will do this for n equals 1, 2, 3, and 4. If we state the equalities, we find a system of equations. There's a lot of ways to solve this, from substitution of the constants one by one to matrix algebra, so choose whatever you want. The values of these constants are these. Finally, with the value of the coefficients, we found an expression of the sum in a simpler form in terms of n. So let's see what we can do with this. Okay, let's finish our job. Recall the expression for the nth approximation of the cone's volume. Remember, dividing by n cubed, multiplying by the sum till n squared. Substitute the sum for the polynomial we found, and divide by n cubed. Now it's time to take the limit as n goes to infinity, according to our approach. And as n gets bigger and bigger, the red terms will drop off to zero. So we will end just with the formula we claim. Really cute!